Yes, hi friends, good evening. It's and welcome back once again on a fairly important and invariably ignored topic on the basic of international tax structuring. So I think many of us would have in our practice would have got this question from our clients. How do I set foot in India? Do I start off as a branch or a subsidiary or liaison office or a project office, as the case may be? So today's discussion, of course, is not much about subsidiaries as it is about the other options available. So one of the important reasons why we have this topic under discussion is when someone enters into India, he needs to be clear about what his immediate objective is and what his longer term objective is going to be. Now, based on the kind of answer someone's going to give, a client is going to give, an option can be chosen. And the intent over the next 30 minutes is to help you make that informed decision on behalf of your client, or help your client make this decision. And what are the steps or caveats in each of these options when a particular option is available, and what is the direction in which our regulators have been looking at each of these options. So that's the broad overview, friends, for today's discussion, and let's move on to the session. So this is the schema. These are the areas where we would be broadly touching upon, and we would also be, of course, looking at the tax implications on these options at a very high level. Yes, to start with. To give you a brief overview of the regulatory history, FEMA, which is, of course, directly under the purview of RBI, controls the setting up and operations of a branch, a subsidiary, a project office, or a liaison office. Of course, in some cases, there is also an overlap of regulation thanks to Ministry of Corporate Affairs. And apart from the Act of FEMA, we all know that RBI governs FEMA more through regulations and notifications than by the Act itself, because the Act only gives RBI a high-level legislative authority, whereas most of the operational aspects are dealt with by way of notifications or circulars and stuff like that. So three of the important regulative amendments in the last 3 years, and the last 2 years, I would say, have been of relevance from beginning from 2018. And also the circulars which we have mentioned. What is a branch office, friends? Okay. And what is a liaison office, and what is a project office? Now, branch per se is an extension of an existing entity located outside India. Again, when I say outside India, it's only in the context of FEMA regulations, what we are discussing. So an Indian entity of a foreign, an Indian arm of a foreign company, which is not distinct from its parent, ideally is called a branch office. Now, from a tax angle, this creates some levels of complication if you are an SSE, because let's say a foreign bank, a bank incorporated in London, has a branch in India. Again, please understand, it's a branch, not an independent subsidiary. In such a situation, the branch in India is an extension of the head office located in London, in which case there is a possibility that during the assessment of the branch, the parent company's books may also be picked up or requested for scrutiny in India. The next aspect is a liaison office. Now, this is an interesting concept where this was introduced mainly when people do not per se have a commercial activity, but are trying to test their waters to do market study, to have their own establishment for communication. So the fundamental purpose of a liaison office, or a definition we can say, it's a place of business to act as a channel of communication between the principal business or the headquarters and its entities in India, However, friends, the most important aspect here is a liaison officer per se is not expected to do any commercial activity. Please understand that. A liaison officer is only considered to be an extension arm for communication. It cannot undertake commercial activity. We have decisions in income tax of whether liaison officer is a PE or not. I'm not getting into that aspect at this point. Might move fairly, and then the discussion would get into the direction. But per se, a liaison officer is not expected to do any commercial or industrial activity. A project officer, again. Now, here is a case where an overseas enterprise has got a project in India. When I say a project, it can be both commercial as well as non-commercial. Let's say World Bank. World Bank is undertaking a slum clearance project in India. Now, that project represents interest of the foreign enterprise, which is executing a project in India. However, when we say a project office is a very specific mandate for a very specific purpose, which differentiate it from a liaison office. A liaison office is only for the purpose of communication, typically for people to understand what the Indian market is, communicating from the ground level in India to its parent enterprises overseas or to its own entities in India. However, a liaison office cannot undertake any commercial activity. A branch office can undertake commercial activity. There is absolutely no restriction in that. A project office also can have commercial transactions. However, they are regulated. Let's see how they are regulated in the forthcoming slides. Next. This is something which is of critical importance, friends, primarily because these were the recent amendments. And in any, like as is the case with any regulation, whenever certain amendments have taken place, it would give us a perspective on the regulatory direction which the regulator wants to look at. So let's look at the amendment in 31st of August 2018. Now, this is to curtail unlawful activities and alleged illegal diversion of funds by various entities with RBI approval in violation of Foreign Contribution Regulation Act. So for those of us who are familiar with FCRA, FCRA was an act which was introduced to regulate monies getting into the non-profit sector. So fundamentally, when an NGO receives a significant amount of funds from abroad in the garb of charity and upliftment of society, and such funds are being used, say, for an antisocial purpose or for a purpose for which the government is not very comfortable raising foreign funds. Now, those are reasons why the government is forced to introduce additional safeguards in that regulation. Now, let's look at the purpose of this amendment or the fundamental. Prior to this amendment, prior approval from RBI was required when the applicant is an NGO or a non-profit organization. However, post the amendment, such NGO or NPO engaged in activities commenced under FCRA, covered under FCRA, shall obtain a FCRA certificate and shall not seek permission from RBI for setting up branch office, project office or liaison office in India. A declaration also needs to be made. So apart from ensuring that the funds are for their purpose, they are also giving a very clear direction that these enterprises shall not seek permission from RBI for setting up any entity which would even seemingly look like commercial enterprises. So the purpose is very clear. FCRA is not meant for a commercial purpose. Entities which obtain funds under FCRA are supposed to use it for the society and not for any commercial gains. The regulation only strengthens the government's perspective in that direction. The subsequent amendment which happened as recent as Jan 2019. Now, this is an amendment which, again, you would have heard a lot of noise being made about Make in India, ease of doing business, India moving up in the World Bank rankings. Prior to the amendment, prior approval of RBI was required when the principal business of the applicant falls in the four sectors: defense, telecom, private security, and information and broadcasting. However, post the amendment, such approval shall not be required where the government approval or license has been granted by the concerned ministry or registrar, because there is an elaborate process for vetting and approving a particular investor who operates in the sectors mentioned here, given the sensitive nature And you would have all seen the recent issue with Huawei, where India and US are having concerns with large Chinese operators operating in the telecom hardware space. Now, when the government by itself perceives any element of threat, it refers the case to Home Ministry, and Home Ministry's feedback is being sought in this regard. Now, for a person to operate in these sectors with so many safeguards already in place, having an additional safeguard in the form of prior approval of RBI is only going to complicate the process of getting all approvals in India. So hence, to ensure that there is an ease of movement of files, or for someone to invest in India, there is an ease of doing business, this amendment has been introduced. Moving further, general permission, friends. So when can you set up a project office? See, these are the basic questions which we will have. So a client will come and ask us, sir, I'm going to do this activity. What is the best way to enter into India? Which we call as the India entry strategy. So in such a case, first we must ourselves be clear as to when you can use any of these options. A foreign company can open a project office in India, provided it has secured a contract from an Indian company to execute a project in India, and the project fulfills certain conditions. So obviously the contract has to be from an Indian company and it fulfills certain criteria. It is funded by overseas remittance, which is why you need a FEMA in place in the first instance. If the project is approved by the respective authority and a public financial institution or a bank has granted a term loan for the project, this is again if funds are required from external agencies. Certain cases, the project may be funded by multilateral international financing agencies. So the funding aspect is optional, because if the foreign company itself has got a project and has the ability to fund the project itself, funding per se may not be a criterion, but the project should have all the approvals in place for it to be viable in India. And more importantly, it should be funded by inward remittance from abroad. Sorry. For the purpose of a branch office. Now look at it, friends. Any foreign enterprise is allowed to set up a branch office in India as long as the sector is FDI approved, 100% FDI approved. The RBI approval is not required to set up branch office in SEZs to undertake manufacturing and allied activities, subject to the unit functioning in sectors where 100% FDI is permitted, units complying within the Chapter 22 of the Companies Act. We'll look at what Chapter 22 of Companies Act is, typically foreign company compliance, and the units function on a standalone basis. Friends, please be very clear. Whenever you're advising a client on setting up a branch office in India, the sector in which the client intends to operate should be a 100% FDA sector. It cannot be a case where there is a 49% or 76% or whatever threshold, because the moment we say a branch, the ownership is 100% abroad. So unless the sector comes under 100% FDI, you will not be allowed a branch license. RBI approval is not required to set up a branch office of a banking company or an insurance company if the company has obtained an approval under Banking Regulation Act, or such insurance company has obtained an approval under the IRDA regulation. You can see the direction, friends, again. The intent of the government is not to burden a person who is willing to do business in India by adding one more layer of compliance with RBI. As we saw in the amendment dated January 2019, where the respective ministries or the government has already approved investments in sectors like telecom or defense, a further approval from RBI is now dispensed with. Similar rationale, where a particular bank has obtained approval under Banking Regulation Act, where again RBI is the regulator, as well as insurance regulatory authority. In such situations, an additional permission from RBI is not required to set up a branch in India. Next, when would you require prior approval, even when general permission is being granted to the SSC? For the following situations, invariably, a prior approval is required. Now, if the applicant is a citizen or registered in Pakistan, obviously we are aware why. A citizen registered in Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Iran, Pakistan again, China, Afghanistan, Macau, Hong Kong, and to open a branch office or liaison or project office in Jammu and Kashmir, Northeast region in Andaman and Nicobar Islands, again purely for strategic or security reasons. The applicant is an NGO or an NPO body or a department of a foreign government. Principal business falls under the four sectors. For opening a PO relating to defense sector, no separate reference or approval shall be required if the applicant has been awarded a contract by Ministry of Defense. So fundamentally, except for those sensitive neighborhoods, invariably there is no additional or no prior approval from RBI which is required. Now this is your chapter 22, friends. What are the compliance per se which MCA insists on? So every foreign company which is registered with the RBI, it should get an established place of business in India, and within 30 days needs to deliver the documents to Ministry of Corporate Affairs, which obviously needs to be attested. And that's an area where our professionals need to be very clear when we are advising our clients in terms of compliance, friends. Ministry of Corporate Affairs has put onerous requirements on the SSC, and we all know the punishments or penal provisions under MCA are fairly draconian of late. Next, and form FNC, which the person resident in India should be submitting it on behalf of the overseas enterprise to the authorized dealer. An authorized dealer shall perform the functions which have been delegated to it by RBI. FNC has to be submitted with the respective documents which are mentioned here. I'm not getting into the specifics of the documents which are mentioned here. Now, this is important, friends. This is, again, one of the most important slides of today's discussion. What are the activities permitted by a branch office or a liaison office? We are not getting into project office because project office, by definition itself, has clearly stated what a project office can do. Typically, you should have a project from an Indian enterprise and the remittances must be from overseas. Now, what are the activities which a branch office can do? It can export or import goods representing a foreign, it can represent a foreign airline or shipping company. This is something which all of us would have seen in various airports. It can render professional or consulting services. I'll get back to you at a later point in time with a very interesting case law what we have on the rendering of professional or consulting services. It can carry out research work in which the parent company, areas where the parent company is interested. Promote technical or financial collaborations between Indian company and the parent company. Representing parent company in India and act as buying and selling agents in India. Rendering services in IT and development of software. Technical support to products supplied by parents. Friends, if you look at it, somewhere this must ring a bell. When we have read section 9.1, there is an explanation which talks about the term business connection. When you look at the permitted activities for a branch office, this resonates a lot with the definition of the term business connection, which we had in India, which we still continue to have, under income tax, where you have someone who habitually maintains stock for delivery, habitually concludes contracts in India, an agent of a non-resident and all those. Something very similar to that, export or import of goods, someone who's engaged in dealing with the inventory, someone who represents a parent company in India. And then, of course, it also includes carrying out research work in which the parent is involved, rendering professional services, rendering services in IT or development of software. Now, let's move on to liaison office. And liaison office, as we saw, friends, cannot engage in themselves in any commercial activity. So that's a fundamental requirement. So if an enterprise has obtained a RBI approval by claiming to start a liaison office and effectively ends up rendering commercial activities, then it's an illegal transaction. There could be penal consequences. Now, a liaison office can represent the overseas head office in India. It can promote export or import between countries. Again, look at it, friends. It has to be more at a very high level engagement. It cannot be transaction specific. Promoting collaborations between the Indian enterprise and the overseas parent. And more importantly, act as a communication channel. So a liaison office typically can be a PR, public relations enterprise, of a foreign company in India. it cannot again and again reiterate engage in any commercial activities. If at all the SSC requires or the applicant requires to carry out other activities, specific approval of RBI is required, and through your AD you can supply. So whenever we go through an approval process, we submit as to why a particular BO or an LO is being set up. So accordingly, a call has to be taken whether it falls within the perspective of what it can do or what it is not supposed to do. Friends, here we have a, okay, let's finish off this activities not permitted and then have a discussion on one area. A BO is not to undertake retail trading activity, cannot carry out manufacturing in India or processing in India, but can subcontract to an Indian manufacturer. We would have seen earlier that a branch office can set up a manufacturing outfit only within an SEZ. But outside an SEZ, it is not allowed to set up an office. And a liaison office, what it cannot do, it cannot undertake commercial activity, it cannot undertake trading activity or industrial activity, it cannot earn income in India. Fundamental stops there. And it should not place orders or sign documents on behalf of the head office. So when you look at what a liaison office, again, RBI has categorically said what it cannot do. Friends, now, with this backdrop, let us look at, though it is not discussed specifically as a slide, I would want to discuss with you the practical implications of having a branch office in India. See, the moment, let us say, a branch office in branch office can be LLP. Sir, branch office will, Mr. Subbarao, sir. So, branch office can only take the constitution of its parent enterprise, sir. If a foreign enterprise is a partnership which wants to set up a branch in India, then it can be, then it will reflect the same constitution. Whereas if it's a company there, it will also reflect the constitution of a foreign company. So, to give you a clear example is, foreign law firms can operate out of India, sir. Based on a recent Supreme Court decision. However, so in such situations, if the law firms abroad are LLPs, they can offer casual consulting in India without rubbing or treading in the wrong side of the Advocates Act. So to come back to your question, it can be an LLP, it can be a company based on the constitution of its parent enterprise. It only mirrors that constitution. Yes. Does a marketing liaison office can be meant promoting or, okay. Mahesh, it's a good question. See, the context when we say marketing is different from sales promotion. So marketing is at the higher level, which can operate where if you look at the scope, which is permitted within the permitted activity of promoting export or import between the enterprises. Of course, yes, you can do. But the larger risk what people are now facing is based on the scope of activity of a liaison office, the income tax department is getting aggressive to understand whether a LO can constitute a PE or otherwise. Because for a branch, there is no question. Invariably, it becomes a PE as far as any non-resident is concerned. For a LO, 99% it will not be a PE. However, based on the scope of work, what it actually carries out, not as indicated by the papers or agreements what we have. Friends, now this is one interesting perspective what the regulators are now taking in India. They are no longer going by what agreements which you sign or what agreements which you actually have. They are doing what is called the principal purpose test, which is substance over form. So when we say, can the LO do marketing in the garb of promoting export or import? If it genuinely does sales promotion in India, it will be picked up because it's a prohibited activity. On the other hand, if it's going to liaise with the chambers of commerce or with ministry for various purposes, that's completely allowed. Next, moving on. Transactions between BO and parent. Sir, yes, sir. Fantastic question, sir. Transactions between branch office and parent company are subject to transfer pricing in India and TP audit. We've got many cases of banks, especially where foreign bank funds the local branch for the purpose of doing business in India and receives interest. That interest has to be subject to transfer pricing. And the larger risk is on the foreign bank itself. So we had this decision in Morgan Stanley, where it's a very interesting Supreme Court decision, where it says if the foreign parent, that's a case where we had a parent and a subsidiary, not a branch, with the same rationale holds equally good for the branch as well, where the foreign parent has compensated the subsidiary on arm's length, would there be a further case of attribution of profits? So where the Supreme Court said if all the activities of the branch have been suitably, of the subsidiary have been suitably compensated, then there is no requirement for attribution of profits. But if you see the recent OECD guidelines on base erosion, BEPS, in such a situation, what OECD says is, whenever an entity in a third-party jurisdiction does work on the basis of a foreign parent, whether it's as a branch or a subsidiary, it is not only important that for the activities performed, it gets compensated on an arm's length basis, it should also be compensated for the profit which the parent has earned consequent to the activities conducted by the Indian branch or subsidiary, as the case may be. In such a situation, one, apart from it being subject to TP audit, there can also be a further consequence of attribution of profits of the foreign parent in India. That's a very big risk, which is now starting with all the branch offices. Of course, it also affects subsidiaries as well in this scenario. Yes, when moving further, what is the qualifying criteria for setting up a branch office? 5 years of profitable operations, minimum net worth of 100,000 as per the REIT's balance sheet. Liaison office, 3 years of profitable operations in the home country and a minimum net worth of $50,000. Please understand, friends, so therefore only an existing enterprise can only set up a branch or an LO. A newly started enterprise cannot form a company abroad and then have its branch immediately in India. That's not allowed. You need to show a track of 3 years or 5 years as the case may be. Project office, foreign company shall be eligible based on the criterion which are mentioned, no specific. However, a letter of comfort may also be obtained from the parent company in situations where the criterions are not expressly prohibited. And we have also seen in certain businesses, letters of comfort being insisted. Post-incorporation, what are the compliances which are required? I'm sorry, I think I missed one question of Mahesh. Price negotiation following logistics. See, price negotiation following logistics, honestly, I feel both these are operational activities, Mahesh. They should not come within the perspective of a liaison office. Post-incorporation, the basic compliance right from PAN, TAN and GST, Shop and Establishment Act, whatever regulations. And apart from if the SSC is from these specific countries, neighbors with whom India has a concerning relationship, obviously a clearance from Home Ministry where you need to make a reference to the state police authorities. And then, of course, opening a bank account. Now, this is what are the permissible incomes and expenditure. Subharasav has asked, when a branch office is not allowed to do trading and manufacturing, okay, then what for it, sir? Very good question, sir. But apart from trading and say a service-based industry, they can operate a marketing outfit. All what Mahesh asked in his questions as to can they do logistics, can they do price negotiation, can they do marketing and sales promotion, all those things can be done by branch office. See, the intent is the government wants. A branch office is only like testing the waters in India. If you really want to be doing serious business in India, you better be a company incorporated out of India. That is the direction of the regulators or nothing else. So you can do peripheral functions. So you can do parts of a P&L, but you cannot do an entire P&L per se. That is their objective. Permissible incomes and expenditure of a liaison office. There is no obviously income. Entire expenditure and a liaison office cannot borrow in India. For a branch office, incomes will come from will be whatever income which is generated in India or from the funds from head office. And any expenditure, again, a branch office cannot borrow in India. Invariably, they end up with the parent. Next, unlimited liability. So this is a very, very big risk, friends. Whenever a foreign enterprise acts in India, the risk of exposing the foreign balance sheet to Indian obligations is very, very high. Which is why when you're advising clients, please tell them very clearly, a subsidiary is a far safer option. Even though it is painful to set up a company and more painful to wind up a company, it is still a better option because the limitation of liability significantly reduces the risk of testing whatever they intend to do in India. Permissible income of a project office. Yes, foreign currency receipts. So please understand, friends, as far as the project office is concerned, the PO should receive funds from its overseas parent or the authority abroad. And whatever expenses relating to the project is what will be allowed here. Now, I'm not getting into, it can open a non-interest bearing foreign currency account in terms of what type of accounts which it can operate. Now, this is important. What are the tax implications? I would like to spend a couple of minutes on this particular slide, friends. A branch office is treated as a foreign company because as we have seen, a branch office is an extension of its overseas body. Now, its income will be taxed at 41, 42, or 43 based on the amount of income. It's nothing but a surcharge function. Now, dividend paid to its parent is not taxed in India. However, if the branch of the Indian branch of a foreign company makes a payment of dividend, makes arrangement for dividend out of India to the shareholders of the foreign parent, not to the parent, but it directly pays to the shareholders of the foreign parent, then the company will be regarded as a domestic company. I'm not the Indian, please understand the language, it will be regarded as a domestic company. The moment it is regarded as a domestic company, its tax rates will come down to 25 or 30%. It will be subject to dividend distribution tax. So this is a tax planning which can be explored based on the facts and circumstances where we can make a foreign company a domestic company by way of paying dividends. And if you look at the language, it says domestic company is a company which has made arrangements to pay dividends to the shareholders of the foreign parent out of the profits which are liable to tax in India. So you don't need to distribute the entire profit. Let's say you earn 10 crores profit, even 1 crore of dividends is distributed. The remaining 9 crores will be taxed at a concessional rate of 25 or 30%, as the case may be. But the concern is the risk of being treated as a permanent establishment of the foreign parent. That's a far larger risk because the moment you're treated as a permanent establishment, as we saw, the balance sheet and P&L of the foreign parent can be dragged into assessments in India. Now, that is where the real challenge lies at this point in time. Next. Annual compliances, it's like similar to your LRS, there's an annual performance report, of course, called differently. The statutory audit, of course, has to be filed by chartered accountants. Annual activity certificate, as we call it in this case, has to be submitted, which, of course, that's where our profession gets involved. And repatriation of funds. Now that obviously you've set up this business, you've created a corpus here, there is whether you made it or it's still your own money, funds can be taken out for a liaison office only on closure. Funds can be repatriated on branch. Profits can be freely repatriated provided the taxes are paid and requisite documents are furnished. For those of us, 15 CACB is one thing which the income tax department insists on. And repatriation of funds to project offices are permitted to make intermittent remittances subject to various documentations. And when you look at it, friends, as far as a liaison office is concerned, ideally a liaison office license is given for 3 years. In certain cases, 2 years. If it's construction development or NBFC, it's given for 2 years. Otherwise, it is 3 years. Where if the person intends to expand the period, he may make an approval for another 3 years. But again, if you look at the language, a liaison office is provided to someone who wants to test the waters in India, who wants to understand, set up an initial communication with various stakeholders in India and overseas. Once that initial space is set right, then the intent or the regulators want them to set up a full-fledged business office, which is why they have not allowed them to do any commercial activities under liaison office. You are allowed to open additional branch offices, and you can shift your existing branch office or a liaison office to any other enterprise. Sorry, to any other location. And yes, closure is also allowed, provided you obtain an NOC from the income tax department, an auditor certificate is required, RBI approval is required. No legal proceedings are there, and a representation has to be made. A report from Ministry of Corporate Affairs from MCA regarding compliance with the various provisions of the Act. Now, this is one very interesting case which I wanted you to discuss, especially given our profiles. So foreign law firms for long have been looking at the lucrative Indian market. And the Bar Council of India had vehemently opposed it, unlike in the accounting fraternity where all the big fours have set up shop in India. Large multinational law firms have not been able to do the same in India. So in 2012, there was this verdict which said of both Madras High Court and there's one other High Court where they said you're not allowed to, there was a stay granted to all the to the right of a foreign law firm to do casual consulting in India. However, in 2018, Supreme Court came back, said, in Bar Council of India versus A.K. Balaji and others, has directed RBI not to grant any permission to a foreign law firm for opening a liaison office in India. Hence, no foreign law firm should be permitted to have a liaison office. However, casual practice is allowed, so they can conduct practice in India. Foreign law firms can conduct practice in India. They can fly in and fly out of India to meet clients, render services. And in limited circumstances, if the tribunal allows, they can represent their clients in India. Legal process outsourcing and BPO, the Supreme Court has said the facts of the transaction have to be viewed on a case-specific basis. So what the Supreme Court order has paved way is they have given the foreign law firms a foothold in the lucrative Indian market. Though they have not opened it up completely, it is a step in that direction. Though the advocates in India have, Bar Council have raised a severe objection, the Honorable Supreme Court has felt that it is in the interest of the profession that foreign law firms should be gradually allowed. As chartered accountants, when you look back, we have large MNCs literally setting up and ruling the Indian market. For the lawyers, this has now become the first case of threat to the Indian practice market, as we may call it. This is one interesting case. But however, one thing, friends, foreign law firms are not allowed to set up liaison offices in India. Now, I would request you to please take the survey here much more for our own selves to understand how we can improve the experience. And if you have any questions in this, please share it with us. We'll be more than glad to attend to it. And as we have gone through this, you would also appreciate when someone comes to you with a dilemma on whether I need to set up a subsidiary or a branch or a liaison office or a PO. If the SSC has a very short-term intent of understanding the Indian market, obviously a liaison office is the most preferred option. A PO, of course, will apply only when there is a, what should I say, when there is a specific project for which a setup has to be created. A branch is where you are clear that you are going to start a commercial activity in India, but you're still not sure whether you want to commit resources to the Indian market. A subsidiary is where you have made up your mind. I would want to go through the subsidiary alternative. Because the chances of a branch being captured as a PE and bringing up the overall parent's P&L to books in India is one serious concern why we invariably avoid recommending branch to our clients. Okay, thank you. It was indeed a pleasure in interacting with you, and hope to catch up next week again on a similarly professionally engaging topic. Thank you, friend. Thanks for your participation.